members, if they have any files or confidential information in front of them, if they don't have to leave the room, can the police make sure that they come over and stay confidential and private to themselves? So the film can now begin, thank you very much. So if we go into the meeting in full, any declarations of interest for any members or officers on any items on the agenda? We do have matters of urgency to exclude the press and public, which is item five and item six. But item five was the exempt minutes from the previous meeting, which, as you got in the pack, is the minutes for the December meeting. Because of the way the system produces the agendas, it should have actually been the minutes from the last meeting, which was the budget meeting. So they will be presented at our next meeting, which is on the 24th of May.
Can I just look at the minutes again? I was actually at this, at that meeting, because I sat next to the PCC. The meeting that we had, 14th of December one. So if you can amend that.
Okay, so item six is then a confidential item, which we are going to press and public evaluation. So item two, which we are going to deal with, which is the next of the previous meeting, apart from the amended reports of attendance. And item three is the information on the governance and security policy.
Thanks, Chair. The purpose of this report, members, is to inform you of the implications of the introduction of the General Data Protection Regulations, which will take effect on the 25th of May, and to request that members approve the Information Governance Security Policy, which is attached to the covering report at Appendix A, which has been revised to reflect the legislative change. Paragraphs 3 to 7 on pages 15 to 16 give an overview of the GDPR as it will affect the service. Paragraph 5 sets out definitions of controllers and processes and how the authority performs both functions. Paragraphs 6 and 7 set out the legal obligations placed on data processors and the penalties for breaches of record keeping, notifications of breaches and privacy impact assessment breaches, which as members will note can be quite significant. The table of paragraph 8 on pages 16 through 18 sets out the significant differences between the extant Data Protection Act of 1998 and the GDPR. The actions taken by the service to implement the GDPR are set out in paragraphs 9 and 10 on page 18. At paragraph 11 on page 19, which directs members to the Information Governance and Security Policy, which is attached to Appendix A on pages 21 through to 25, and that's been revised by officers and is submitted to members for your approval at this meeting today. I appreciate that this is quite a dry subject, members. I've not spoken in any great detail to this, but the information is contained within the report. However, if you do have any questions, myself and Janet would be more than happy to field and follow you as best as we can. Thanks.
Okay. If there are any questions, I know that members will have received a presentation for their lunch on the 24th of May, prior to the next authority meeting. So, obviously, we've got the elections to go through, and if the members who will be appointed to make sure that you attend that, their lunch to get more in depth sort of presentation, what's how it impacts on the service and how we. As elected members have to deal with any data protection issues. Any questions or comments on that?
Agreed.
James?
I realise it's early days on this yet, Chair, but I was wondering if we've assigned any specific audit days to GDPR protocols as of yet, or if that's something which we'll be still in the process of getting together.
Chair, a small working group in the authority that's been dealing with the implications of this for some considerable months now, since we first had notice of the legislation coming in. So it's not been a particular surprise to us. I've been going around doing lots of briefing sessions and awareness sessions with teams of staff across yet allocated any odd days, but I've no doubt at all that we will be doing that as part and parcel of plan of work going forward.
Okay. Can we approve the recommendation of the board?
Great, Jim.
Okay, item four is the population going on self-direct photo coverage.
Mr Chair, the purpose of this report is to advise members of progress made in relation to the multi-agency holding and self-neglect protocol, which within the report is referred to by the acronym MHSP, so that's when you come across that acronym, so that I will refer to that as the protocol as I'm speaking to this report. Members might recall that the protocol was developed following a double fatality at a property at Mount Avenue in South Liverpool on the 23rd of October 2016. Paragraphs 3 to 6 on pages 27 through to 28 set out the background to the development of the protocol, which was set out within the board CFO 1817, and the specific actions arising following the issue of the Regulation 28 letter from the coroner, who presided over the inquest into the double fatality, where hoarding was identified as a contributing factor in relation to the loss of life. To remind members, the Regulation 28 issue is issued by a coroner when they consider that actions can be taken by statutory bodies and others to prevent future losses of life. In this instance, the issue raised was in relation to the powers of entry of the Fire Rescue Service to a private dwelling where there is evidence of hoarding. And that Regulation 28 letter was directed to the Home Secretary on the road. The response to the Regulation 28 letter is set out in paragraph 5 on page 28. And members may recall from the previous report on this issue that let's say that Amber Rudd was assisted substantially in her response by the service. We drafted the response, complaining about it. It was very much our response, and our Home Secretary was of the view that what we were suggesting was absolutely appropriate in the circumstances. Paragraphs 7 through to 16 set out the circumstances around which the protocol has been used for the first time. It's probably worth, members, if I just talk you through, not in great detail, because there's some confidentiality aspects to this, as you appreciate, but if I just give you an essence of the way that this has been used. A safeguarding incident was brought to our attention by North West Ambulance Service. They attended the property on the 16th of December of 2017. The occupier was found in the hallway. It's fair to say that there was very significant evidence of hoarding and in truth living in some quite poor conditions, really. So an emergency meet was then convened in the Cunard building on the 28th of January, following the referrals that we received from MWAS, and it was clear to us that the family themselves were not going to engage in relation to allowing us into that property voluntarily to make interventions. And as we will remember from certainly the incident in Ballard Avenue, we found that to be the case then as well. The family was just not prepared to let us go in and undertake any actions that would make them safe. If you recall the Ballard Avenue incident, there was when we'd been visited the property on a number of occasions, we were faced with things like smoke alarms taped onto the front door and issues such as that. Secured a warrant of entry for the property on the 6th of February. And on the 7th of February, a multi-agency team along with our officers entered the property and made some fairly significant interventions in terms of removing removing a good proportion of the holding from the property as is set out in paragraph 13, and then allowed us to then put smoke alarms and other measures to make the family safer. And of course, it doesn't just affect the individuals in the property. You take the instance of Manor Avenue, that was a semi-detached property, and the people on the other side of that property as well, and clearly are placed at risk by this behaviour. It's an important case study, you should appreciate, because what it shows is that the proposals that we made back to the Home Secretary took on board and responded to the Regulation 28, it shows the positivity. before the first time ever we managed to get in and make an intervention. Paragraphs 15 to 16 set out the actions that we intend to take to disseminate the learning from this particular case study. So that's going to be a post on the National Fire Chiefs Council Communities of Practice and a presentation at the next Home Safety Committee on the 2nd of May. And Phil will also write back to the Liverpool Corner, the Bellow and Amberwood to advise them of the actions that were taken in this instance and to give some reassurance that that we have acted on the recommendations and there has been a tangible and positive outcome as a result. Pause at that point, I'm just going to be happy to take any questions you might have.
Thanks, you. Any questions, Peter?
Yeah, thanks, Chair. Yeah, I'd just like to, you know, certainly welcome this this protocol. And I think what we should be doing is, if it hasn't already been done, a press release has been sent out. Because once again, we see Merseyside Fire and Rescue Service at the forefront. And again, the first for us, once again, in introducing this protocol, when really we should have the powers given to us via legislation in order for our people to, our staff, to actually go into premises without seeking government approval. But then environmental officers can go in, the police can go in, although with a warrant and get a warrant within an hour or so. Well, we should be able to go in when it's a life and death situation, not just to arrest or to check if someone's got rats on them out of the property. This is really, there's very, very serious cases that have been highlighted here in this report, and I think that should be out there that what we're doing is, it is a first for us. And I was also asked that not just to go to the, you know, the next NFCC Home Safety Committee and Fire Chiefs Council, but also that this should be on the agenda for Merseyside Community Safety Partnership, and certainly should be on the agenda for all of our community safety partnerships across each of the local authorities to be discussed and to get, you know, to get the sort of, well, to get the support. And if any letters need to go off to the Home Secretary pleading the case for this to be, for the fire service to be given the legislative powers to intervene immediately, well, then that happens. Because what we don't want, we've had two again. We've got two examples there. What we don't want is a third one and be able to say, didn't we tell you this? Yeah. Let's get in there. We've been very proactive as a service and as an authority under the Chief and Deputy Chief and staff. And I think that needs to be reciprocated by the government also. But it certainly needs out, putting out there that this is what Merseyside Fire and Rescue is doing and this is what we do best.
Thanks, Chair. Mine was just to say congratulations on this because I learnt about it on our workshop and I didn't know that the protocol or anything like that. But I took it back to our council and I took it to the exec of this, the housing part, and they're now looking into it to make the Knowsley also become like Liverpool, where it's become that, you know, it's a thing. So I think we all should do that for each of our councils and make sure that we all join up together. Thanks, Chair.
Thank you, Chair. I mean, that was exactly my comment, really, because obviously it says in paragraph 6 that Knowsley and Wirral are hopeful to actually take on this particular protocol. Can I just ask, from the fire service point of view, I mean, clearly we were delighted with the news from Deputy Chief this week that fire deaths have fallen to a level, you know, beyond which we would have never have dreamt, really. And clearly, whilst four fire deaths are far too many, it's still good to see that fire deaths are going down. And again, quite clearly, this type of behaviour is such, you know, a minefield, really, and it needs to be taken in from every single local authority. Can I just ask, from the Merseyside Fire and Rescue point of view, where we're up to with Wirral? So that I can go back there, and I'm sure I don't have to, but challenge, you know, if there are any holdups as to why.
For the, rather than the rather than commit to something now, Leslie, that I'm not, I believe that progress is being made with Will, but let me determine the extent of that and revert back to you outside of the meeting, if you'll indulge. Because I don't want to say something now that isn't factually correct, but I believe that significant progress is being made across all five local authority areas, but I will confirm that for the members for you.
I think it's right that this protocol should be adopted in the certain district councils, and we'll do that. We'll do whatever we can to make sure that we're with the other agencies or partners and we are close to where the standard is. And I recall that when we received the report from the coroners following the tragic death of those two individuals in Madden Avenue, where the coroner actually called on the government to give the fire and rescue service the authority to go into the premises, that the government didn't feel necessary to change the legislation to give us the authority to do that. And I think, you know, this is proven on that. If we have the methods in place, the procedures in place, it can work. But if there was any delay in undertaking this action, for the local authority has the powers to gain entry and we don't, and the unfortunate circumstances, if there was an incident and a fire death on this, then, you know, that would have been on the heads of those, you know, government officials really, on not heeding to our calls, but more so the calls of the coroner. Because the job that we do, we're about preventing deaths, fire deaths, and that's a testament for the work that we've undertaken over the last 10 years at least. That's helped us reduce the amount of fire deaths that we see on Merseyside today. And that's a credit to our service, under the, you know, difficulty and challenges that we face with the cuts. We're still leading the way on targeting vulnerable tenants. And, you know, members may recall there was an issue, I think it was on the BBC Northwest tonight. I think it was a family in Cheshire, where they were evicted from their property because of home. And to me, you know, I think, you know, it might seem harsh, but it's done for the right reasons. It's about their safety and the safety of the occupants of that property. And also the neighbouring properties and our firefighters, putting our firefighters at risk. You know, because when you've seen the reports on the television and you've seen the inside of the property, it was a hazard. It was a death trap. And, you know, we're not doing it for the sake of it. We're doing it because there's a necessity to protect those individuals and the property. And if people can't see that, it's that common sense that, you know, it's not from our point of view, it's there. They need to change their lifestyle. And I think when we look at what's happening in the country, people that are more independent living, again, people who are holding more, you know, people with mental health issues, I think this issue is going to become more and more relevant. And I think we need to make sure that we still continue to lobby to get those powers for entry, for being aware of those policies, because it is about prevention. That's what it's about. It's about prevention. It's not about people. It's about us preventing a fatality or, you know, anything serious that happens to the occupants or the joint occupiers or firefighters. So we're doing it in the best interests of the individuals. And we're there with our partners to try and help and assist. So hopefully this will, Peter's right, if we do a press release, send out that message that it's about safety first and we're there to help people. And then we should be working together with this to make sure that we get the right outcomes, because we don't want to keep on having to attend other coroners' inquests and having to give evidence about the reasons why, sadly, these people died in a house fire and couldn't be prevented. And that's our job, and that's our responsibility. So with that, can we...
Sorry to come back. I should have mentioned it before. Can I just ask what the service is doing in relation to removing some of this type of, we call it debris, detritus, whatever you want to call it, hoarding material? Because obviously it was a major part of what the work of the Fire Support Network used to do, and clearly they're no longer in being anymore. So can you just outline what we do as a fire service? Have we got protocols within local authorities to actually go in ourselves and remove?
To answer the specific question, look at the, so paragraph 12 sets out the describes the agencies involved in the intervention itself. So, to be clear, powers do exist to enter properties where haunting is evident. They're just not our powers, they are powers of the Rescue Dog Authority. And if you look back onto the paragraph 6, this is not the long before the Mandan Avenue incident, we as a fire rescue service have been proposing a protocol that would allow for these interventions to be made. It's only since the Mandan Avenue incident under Regulation 28, letter from the coroner to run the board, that we've actually got the leverage now to move this on, as you can see within the paragraph 6, because it makes the point to say that initially our ask was rejected. It's only been adopted since the Regulation 28. So the actual mechanics of the intervention is that the environmental health officers have the powers. They are the people who remove the debris. Our role in that intervention is to fit smoke alarms, give advice around fire safety, fire planning and so forth. So that is what we do. The adult social care element of that is the all of dealing with the mental health issues, let's say, whatever the issues that are specific to the individuals. So it is very much a multi-agency approach where each agency draws on its specific powers and duties to achieve the whole outcome, if that makes sense. So to go back to, these powers exist, they just don't rest with us. And what we recognise is actually they don't need to rest with us as long as other agencies work with us to intervene and to act when we come to them with an issue. And that has been the essence, if you like, of the Home Secretary's response. And it is that which we wish to play back. And I think just to take up Councillor Brennan's point at the press release, which I agree with absolutely, I think in order for us to do that, it would have to be a multi-agency press release. It probably isn't something that we would do unilaterally, but certainly we will take an action to go away and look at that, because the point you make there is absolutely right. It is something that does need to be disseminated more widely, and absolutely the Community Safety Partnership agenda is absolutely the place that it needs to be. So I'm grateful to all members for your comments on that and certainly action.
Okay,
good.
John? Thanks, Jay. The Chief mentioned that the work is taken across all five authorities, although we are mentioned on there. If there's anything we can do with regards to that, happy to take that up.
Yeah, you could say it's rather lackadaisical of other providers in the city that this hasn't been noticed before, because this is not in short of what we should have adopted, what we used to call the common assessment framework, where everyone should be switched on. I brought this up last year. We had the adult social health and care over a particular care home in the city, where I said, well, you know, if the carer didn't notice it, the cleaner should have noticed it. The person who gives the dinner should have noticed it. So it's everyone's responsibility. And if you ever watch the programmes on Horden, which I do, because they're based in the States, most of the people have got mental health problems, or something dramatically happened to them in their lives, and it's a compensation for what they've lost or what they've gone through. Where's the social workers and all this? You know, so once again, to reiterate what Peter said, I'm so proud of this. I find rescue, the chief and all the staff, for bringing this to, you know, where it is at the moment. But it is a multi-agency.
It's a new story for us. Just before we move on to the exclusion of the press and public, I've just been made aware by the chief as we were coming in that he wishes to just make a few words. I think you'll like to know.
Thank you, Chair. I'm very conscious at the last meeting, the Chair spoke described as exemplary service to this authority and indeed as a councillor. And as is the way with these things, it would have been remiss of us as officers not to just show a small token of our recognition. There's a couple of aspects to this, one of which we'll be taking up outside of this meeting, but there are just a couple of small items that we would like to present to Dave just as a token of our very significant appreciation for for all of his support and substantial commitment to this authority and its officers during what can only be described as a size of exemplary service. So, at risk of embarrassing you.
Fantastic work we do here